Humanity has often lived with one foot on land and the other in the sea. But in the future, we may build our homes in the seas, here and on other worlds. Most of Earth's surface is water, and the most valuable property tends to be right along the coast, so it's not surprising the idea of artificial islands has been proposed many times. Generally, projects to accomplish them have been few in number and mixed successes at best even then. But that's exactly the role technology has, taking things which were impossible or impractical before, that we really want to do, and making them possible and practical. So today we'll be looking at artificial islands, as well as other ocean habitats, here and off Earth, from deep-sea submarine habitats to rotating space habitats designed to emulate ocean conditions. We'll be deep diving, living in the ocean, so we will be at it for a while, and you might want a drink and a snack for the journey. And please hit the like and subscribe buttons while you're at it. Now, this is SFIA, so we're not really interested in one small island built where the sea is only a few meters beneath low tide anyway, but rather mass manufacture or raising whole archipelagos or even small new continents. That means we need to be thinking of the non-local impact. As an example, when we talk about the tip of an iceberg, it's because ice is only slightly less dense than water, so a big chunk of ice floating in the sea is mostly submerged with only the tip floating out. Rock isn't floating, and so an island sticks out because it's really a submerged mountain. Mauna Kea, while submerged for most of its height, is a massive shield volcano located on the Big Island of Hawaii, and is considered one of the tallest mountains in the world when measured from its base on the ocean floor, rather than by sheer altitude above sea level like Mount Everest. The estimated volume of Mauna Kea, including its underwater portions, is approximately 32,000 cubic kilometers, or 7,680 cubic miles. It is one of five shield volcanoes that form the island of Hawaii, and not the largest, and the whole island is just 4,000 square miles or 10,000 square kilometers. The ocean is pretty deep on average, a few kilometers or miles, though less near the coast of course, and what it means is that even a fairly narrow cone of an island sticking out from the ocean depths is using up several cubic kilometers or miles for any land area equivalent. You have to get that material either by digging some part of the ocean deeper or knocking a mountain over into the ocean, which might be fine. A knocked over mountain might provide a lot more useful living area as a new piece of flat land plus an island. But now the ocean is rising a bit to compensate, plus putting several billion new tons of weight on a piece of underwater surface, while removing a mountain from somewhere is going to lift that weight off, and both can have secondary effects. Every cubic mile you add to the ocean of new rock or water is raising the ocean depth by 0.000456 inches, or 11.5 micrometers, so it would take about 2,200 cubic miles to raise it 1 inch, and based on the value of Mauna Kea, that would raise it 3 inches. In metric, a cubic kilometer of rock is adding 2.8 micrometers, and 361,000 cubic kilometers to get a meter of ocean rise. So, needless to say, one or two small islands built on the coast where the ocean is only a few tens of meters deep is not problematic, but deciding to build the continent of Atlantis or Pacifica could be an issue. We could pump excess water up to space habitats, and we'll talk about water habitats later, or we could pile it onto the poles themselves. Pumping huge amounts of water there to form artificial ice mega mountains is one of the short-term bandage solutions for handling a warming planet we've kicked around in other episodes. But it would seem to make more sense to build your artificial islands in one of three other ways. First, you do it by the coasts, which benefit from placing new land nearby areas that are already pretty valuable real estate, and also gives you the option of doing peninsulas instead of full islands, or ones with narrow and easily bridgeable channels that boats could go under. This also lets you do long, snaky islands easier, which would tend to be more valuable as it provides more coastline property than an equal area circle or square, which alternatively gives you your most surface land for underwater mass, a flattened cone needing less volume than a big long line or wavy curve whose sides have to slope out. Second, you take advantage of existing underwater mountains and just build on them, as we do have a huge mountain range running down the middle of the Atlantic. Indeed, on some planet you were terraforming, you might be comfortable nuking or bombarding those to blow a volcano in them back to life. The thought is that you can build a raft instead that floats on the water, which is still displacing water but displaces it regardless of the ocean depth. Indeed, on some worlds where the ocean may be tens of kilometers deep, this might be your only plausible option. Note, by the way, that option 0, just pile tons of mass on some deep and flat section of the ocean, is only a bad option for Earth. If you have a planet with less water on it and taller mountains, and not much weathered down continents yet, which might be normal for younger planets, this might be a very good approach to getting a nice land-to-sea ratio while also getting you some living room. The early protocontinents didn't much resemble modern ones. They were smaller and less stable, more volcanic and more granitic, helping them float over the more basaltic and denser ocean floors. They also sank and recycled a lot more often. The oceans were a lot hotter and more acidic back then too, and we need to be ready for some very non-Earth-like conditions for possible terraforming, especially if life turns out to be common out in the galaxy, since we might feel ethically limited to dead worlds needing either heavy terraforming or being young and more like the primordial Earth, where you might need to be doing some serious bulldozing in order to get livable spaces. Now, as you might guess, our biggest focus for today is on artificial islands of this raft variety, though describing them as a raft is not universally accurate. You might want a big ship of an island able to move, but otherwise you need to anchor your island in place. And more to the point, you are probably structurally supporting it from below on big towers or pylons to the ocean floor. Indeed, you don't need the raft to be buoyant by this approach. But the less weight you put on those pylons, by instead floating on water, the smaller those need to be. This does not necessarily need to be wasted space either. You probably don't want hollow ones, that defeats the purpose, but a big pylon shaft 100 meters wide could get away with having an extra 10 or 20 meters of pressurized living areas bolted on the side. If we imagine for the moment a 100 meter wide pylon that could support a square kilometer of land above, then it's using a little under 1% of the area of the land it's holding up, as opposed to more than 100% in the form of some abridged cone of a mountain. It might need to spread out like tree roots at the bottom to spread the weight around, but it is still taking less volume as some long-necked hourglass than a flat cone. Alternatively, a support pylon holding up a square kilometer of land over, say, 3 kilometers of ocean's depth is now a tower that could have about 1,000 floors bolted onto the side of it, and keeping them pressurized while adding to ocean displacement is taking some of the weight off that pylon too, not adding it as you'd expect with a normal structure built on land up in the air. Three dimensions beats two in this case, as we imagined a 15 meter or 50 foot ring around the pylon for each floor. That's 5,400 square meters of floor and 1,000 floors for 5.4 square kilometers of living area on our pylon holding up 1 square kilometer of land. That's 2 square miles of living area around that pylon, supporting 0.39 square miles. I'm not sure how appealing life on a giant underwater pylon would be, especially after the first 100 meters when everything starts getting dark, but you might have strings of lighting going down to see the ocean around you, and even to boost the local ecology. We've talked about the notion of vertical reefs before, in a fusion economy or one with superabundant orbital power transmission, and those pylons might make beautiful additions to local marine ecology. You might even extend a mesh out from an artificial island inside the epipelagic zone where the sunlight reaches to allow nutrients to collect that were pumped up along that pylon. Most of the sunlight hitting the ocean is wasted once you get away from the shore because there's just not enough nutrients and footholds for serious ecology to grow, even though more than half our planet's sunlight is going down into that. Most of our planet's biomass is on land. Almost all the remainder is on the coastal areas and lakes where the floor still gets sunlight. You could change that a lot with such islands allowing nutrient and sunlight to be in the same place. For that matter, floating solar panels or farms might collect a large local reef around and under them, feeding the local fish and creating huge amounts of marine snow to feed lower levels of that ocean. When you're building land, not just occupying existing land, the options change, verticality becomes a real option both under and over water. Indeed, the original cover art that inspired the episode, showing the big floating pyramid-shaped building on the sea, becomes a real option too. And pyramids are one of our more common arcology design shapes. It works on water just as well. Alternatively, smaller mobile islands that just float on the water have a lot going for them. One of the neater things about floaty islands is that you can probably build them in segments and disconnect and move them around, letting you shuffle up your landscape and real estate too. This might be a neat arrangement of hexagonal islands or more haphazard collection of floating rafts of every shape and size. These might connect to some more central and more stationary island too, either a natural one or one of our examples where it's connected to a pylon down to the ocean floor. Indeed, such a pylon and key island would make a fairly natural downtown region. Those other units might be other homes, large houseboats essentially, or even entire neighborhoods. They also might be oceanic farms or factories too, or even reactors. There's a lot of reasons to farm the oceans, which we'll return to in a moment, but there's a lot of reasons to be building artificial islands, and one of those is to avoid regulations by being out in international waters. Some, like a mobile rocket launch pad, make a lot of sense to have as a detachable platform in the ocean, where you can wind out away from everyone else when a launch or landing is upcoming, and is a fairly benign purpose. On the darker side of things, international waters are attractive to those in the black market, including human trafficking. Indeed, we suggest detachable sections and assume they are all sailing off, but they could be submersibles too, rising only to conduct transfers, or even docking underneath rather than above. Somewhere in the grayer regions, and your mileage may vary, would be everything from smuggling and black markets to casinos, surgical facilities, houses of ill repute, factories producing products to avoid taxes and tariffs, or environmental and labor regulations. We talked about some of these options more way back in our Seasteading episode, but they bear repeating as building an island is never going to be cheap. And while we may do it down the road to make more living space, the initial efforts will be about accessing some advantage the ocean has besides simple size, and a big one is that it's not exactly governed. At the same time, artificial islands could change that. Nobody is likely to allow pirate nations to arise and prosper off their coast. For that matter, planting a bunch of artificial islands out from your coast is a good excuse to claim your territory extends to them and that international waters start further out from them, not your coast. They then become ideal places for military installations and airport or marine stopovers, which could justify a good deal of financial subsidy from whatever nation was claiming them or building them. Ocean farming is another good reason to push into the seas, as is ocean solar or wave power generation, and for the same reasons. These take a lot of space, and that's something the ocean has. So too, the sort of wide metal mesh we use for absorbing microwaves beaming down from orbital power satellites can be built here while also being near a lot of cities to avoid power transmission losses. Indeed, they could likely work right in the middle of a big fish or algae farm and potentially even assist in its function. Similar to greening the tundra or desert, farms built in the ocean are likely to have positive knock-on effects for the local ecology too, if done properly. You are technically destroying the local environment by altering it to have more biomass, but by and large, that will help the local food chain by increasing the baseline inputs. So it's mostly about ensuring you're taking the steps to avoid endangering any species, and there's a lot of ocean to work with. In an era where land prices will keep rising, more people work remotely, and high-speed internet can be made available even in the middle of nowhere, including the seas, I could easily imagine folks deciding they want their ideal suburban household to be built on a big raft they can move around, floating up and down the east or west coast, or through the Mediterranean or Caribbean, parking sometimes for a day and sometimes for a year. They could potentially still include a garage with a car, as opposed to a boat, but in these days of Uber that would seem less necessary and would open up an entire economic niche to delivery drones and boat taxis. We already have some emergent equivalents to boat cities. Venice is not the only city whose streets are made of water, and there's quite a few throughout Europe and East Asia, along with many a city whose coastal buildings are up on stilts and have a lot of houseboats nearby. These places are not new and modern, many go back centuries before ocean-going vessels were common and safe. And floating agriculture is not new either. Indeed, raft farming in Mesoamerica, the Chinampas, has a long history. We are more interested in ocean habitats today, not coastal spots, but that's where a lot of it would begin, and also where folks might circulate to. If your habitat is mobile, you might as well move it to see the world and take advantage of new options. Whether you're farming fish or algae or rice, or even doing domed vertical greenhouses, that mobility is a nice option as it lets you move to the best climate or weather nearby, and you obviously never have to fear a drought. But that mobility also lets you bring your produce to the best port for prices or handling. I could see it being a very attractive lifestyle for a family or modest community. I think your larger ocean cities, though, are likely to be built around tourism, transport, and defense, and that tourism including medical procedures and contraband. Down the decades, that might shift to more normal city economies, but the early days are likely to influence how the habitat develops, much as we discussed in our Prison Space Colonies episode. You might dump prisoners someplace for a generation or two to help while conditions are harsh and uninviting, and a century later it's just a normal settled planet. But that's part of its history and outlook, same as Australia or any of the other penal colonies. And much like Alcatraz and other island penitentiaries, you might decide an artificial island is a good place to put a prison. Indeed, the lower levels of one of those support pylons might be a very good choice if the real estate wasn't too inviting, since it's easy to seal those off, and an escape by deep-sea submersible is possible, but a lot harder than coming in with a boat to an island prison. Same, it's not a bad place for a dangerous lab, and dangerous or illegal research is another thing that ocean habitats might attract. Indeed, dangerous viruses or nanomachines, virulent and robust as we think of them, would probably not survive even briefly in a saltwater environment of hundreds of atmospheres of pressure, making them potentially better for a lab than up in space. These are all things that might permit you to build expensive facilities, though of course you might have problems getting an insurance policy on anything dangerous and expensive, even if it were not illegal or otherwise full of criminals. There is also the question of handling big storms, hurricanes, and tsunamis, which is a good place to transition to more off-planet discussions. Right now, our entire catalog of exoplanets, even if it is in the thousands, does not include much Earth-like, though probably not because planets of our size and temperature are uncommon. It's easier to see planets that are close to their sun, meaning very hot, or very large, and most of the known exoplanets are both. None are in the Mars, let alone Pluto range, but those icy dwarfs like Pluto are probably the most numerous in the galaxy, and also probably the last to be found. We also don't really know how common watery planets with oceans are, just that lower mass planets like Mars probably can't retain ocean atmosphere unless they are far enough from their sun that those oceans are buried under ice or buried under some thick atmosphere like Titan has. We may encounter them when they are newer planets and still had them, though. Earth is no example to use either, as our own early planet got smashed by something Mars-sized to make our moon and jettisoned any original seas and sky we had with them. We think we got it back during a cometary bombardment phase provoked by a planetary migration, but that's not much reason to assume that sequence of events is anything like normal. Because we have a lot of interactions between the crust and mantle, it's a little overly simplistic to think of a planet as having a craggy surface of rock that gets covered by water to whatever depth that volume of water allows. But let's go with that for the moment. Water itself is just about the most common substance in the universe, if we exclude molecular hydrogen, helium, and of course, dark matter. Almost every atom in this universe dates within the first minute after the Big Bang, when the conditions of the universe were similar to those inside a supernova, and fusion was occurring in mere instants, not spread over billions of years like the typical stellar core. I think folks assume it was almost all hydrogen in the early universe, and all helium, like all our other matter, is left over from dead stars. But in fact, very little hydrogen has been fused into helium since then, more than other elements, but most helium is a relic of that period. Had the universe expanded and cooled just a hair slower, we'd have a lot more helium, and a lot more other heavier elements, but only a few percent of the atoms in existence came about as products of stellar fusion, and the majority of those are helium and oxygen. Helium does not bond to anything. Oxygen bonds to darn near everything, and hydrogen is super abundant, so the universe is full of water. Most of everything is either a bunch of hydrogen bonded to some other common element like carbon or nitrogen, in the form of methane and ammonia, or some less common element bonded to oxygen, like aluminum, iron, and silicon, which makes up most of what we think of as rock. If we assume the amount of water an early planet has is proportional to its mass, twice as much mass, twice as much water, then we have a big problem. Earth again is not a good baseline due to how we lost our earliest surface and gained our oceans back, but if it were, a planet twice Earth's mass would be expected to be 26% wider and 59% bigger in surface area, and 26% higher surface gravity too, which would make it harder for lighter elements like hydrogen and helium to escape. If it began with twice as much water, then with 59% more surface area, it is 26% deeper too. And might be even more so since there's more hydrogen around from gravity looking for oxygen to bond with. On Earth, where the average ocean depth is 3.7 kilometers or 12,000 feet, being 26% deeper would be another kilometer or 3,100 feet, more than half a mile. There is plenty of Earth that's more than half a mile or a kilometer above sea level, but most of it is not. What's more, a planet with higher gravity probably is flatter. Keep in mind on Earth, radius 4,000 miles, the place is already pretty flat, with almost everything within plus or minus 1% of that radius, ignoring variation from the poles and equator, and a few anomalies like Mount Everest or the Marianas Trench still within 2%. That variation is probably less on more massive worlds. Everything wanting to slide down has more force pulling it down. Every volcano blowing up has more gravity pulling it down. Those deeper oceans also erode more than air, and the atmosphere is probably thicker too, causing more erosion. All in all, you probably have a much flatter surface covered much deeper in water on any planet more massive than Earth that might actually have a meaningful equivalent to surface for us to colonize, unlike a gas giant or ice giant. That means a lot of ocean planets, and the reverse, less massive planets than Earth, are probably either pretty thin on sea and sky, having less to begin with and losing them faster to solar wind, or pretty cold and icy, or are pretty young. And Earth's continents are also pretty young. We didn't get real continents until the planet was a couple billion years old. Loosely speaking, since heavier elements we need for rocky planets are growing more common as the universe ages, most rocky planets are probably younger than Earth, even if most solar systems are older. These and smaller planets, Martian equivalents and in-betweens, we probably have to bring oceans into by cometary bombardment, which is going to be a huge and time-consuming effort on human historical timelines and scales. That means we may be wanting to create artificial marine habitats for oceanic life. For those planets more massive than Earth, or those that might be our size but didn't get whacked with another planet and still got a cometary bombardment, we should expect deeper seas, and that means floating cities becomes a better approach to terraforming. Indeed, those big pylons might not be so much for support as a means of moving material up from the ocean floor and mantle to the surface for us to use. Submarine habitats get to be rather interesting in cases like this, as it lets you avoid bad surface weather, which can be more extreme on different planets, and will generally go with how much sunlight planets get, how wide it is, how big a moon it's got, and how fast it spins, or how long its day is. Generally speaking, it's a bad idea to be near a hurricane, but most modern large vessels can survive them. It is very likely we could engineer artificial islands to be even more durable. That said, some big raft city might find it a better idea to submerge during the worst of a storm. We see this with the floating island city of Atlantis in Stargate Atlantis. This implies a dome over the surface, but that's probably normal for anything built on an alien planet anyway. It also might be normal for any artificial island built for Arctic conditions too. Nor do you necessarily have big open green spaces that need domed in, but if we do, then you can't submerge unless you have a way to cover that. An energy shield like those ubiquitous in sci-fi would obviously work. That's how Atlantis in Stargate does it. But sadly, we haven't got a clue how to make such a thing. Building habitats designed to be under the water isn't too hard either. You just have to give yourself compartments you can flood and blow clear if you want to rise. And if you've got a good power source, you can always vaporize water to blast out of your tanks to go float to the surface. Given that you have to spend money and effort to truck in heavier building materials, there's no reason to make an artificial island any heavier than it needs to be to float. So some compartments you can flood or pump empty to let you submerge or rise is honestly a fairly minimal addition. Another thing to keep in mind is that we are hardly limited to glass these days. We have various substances, mini ceramic, that are transparent and some as strong as steel, and probably will be able to mass manufacture diamond inside the century. When diamond windows become normal in people's houses, which I suspect will happen by century's end, unless we get something better, building a diamond dome over your island, maybe even a retractable one, becomes a lot easier to imagine, and also lets you sink that thing down into ocean trenches if you feel like it. See our episode Colonizing Oceans for more discussion of deep sea life on the floor of oceans. As those artificial habitats for oceanic life, that's a bit trickier. We did deep dive some in our marine habitats episode, like the hydro shell, but fundamentally, the problem with a spin gravity environment, like an O'Neill cylinder, is that your structure has to hold all that weight. So it's much easier to go with lower gravity or lower depth of sea. Most marine life does live near the surface, of course, so that's fine. And for life adapted to live in the very deep sea where the sun don't shine, there is likely to be a million icy moons we could convert to such habitats. Those with subsurface oceans under the sea can be fed nutrients from artificial marine snow of whatever civilization and hydroponics you have built on, in, or under that surface layer of ice, or fed by geothermal energy from thermal vents on the ocean floor, powered by tidal forces from whatever planet it orbits. I think a big takeaway though for this episode, as we wrap up, is to keep in mind that most of the Earth is ocean, and many worlds of our size or larger will be as much or more ocean themselves, and that water is one of the most common substances out there. So the future of humanity is likely to involve a lot of ocean living, which is probably appropriate given that we are mostly made of water ourselves. We were talking about privacy a few weeks back and worries it's going away. I think part of the reason why we might see the artificial islands we discussed today get popular in the future is a desire for more seclusion. One downside of being a public figure is it's harder to keep your privacy, and I get bombarded by hacking attempts all the time, so I can't slack on security, but as AI gets more sophisticated, it gets easier to go after anyone, not just high-profile hacking targets. If you value your privacy, take steps to protect it. And online, that means using a virtual private network, or VPN, like NordVPN. This lets you hide your IP address from sites you visit and hackers, but NordVPN also has tons of additional security features and threat protection, which includes a specific feature to warn you about phishing links, as well as features like a blocker for malicious ads, and dark web monitoring to alert you if passwords have been leaked. And all these features come with a robust VPN so you can protect your data and unblock region-specific content. The best part? You can try it with no risk. Nord has a 30-day money-back guarantee, so you can try it for yourself and decide. Go to nordvpn.com/IsaacArthur to get the 2-year plan and some additional months for free. So that's it for today, but join us next Thursday, October 24th, where we'll be exploring some potential pathways for life and purpose that people in the distant future might pursue, including post-human options like having their brain melted into a forest, or mountain, or island, or even a whole planet. Then in 2 weeks we'll go the other direction, into the very distant past, to look at the dark stars that first formed our universe near the beginning of time. After that, we'll wrap up October with our Halloween episode, Ghost Armadas and Primordial Galactic Wars, to consider ancient interstellar battles and leftover weapons from those dawn times. If you'd like to get alerts when those and other episodes come out, make sure to hit the like, subscribe, and notification buttons. You can also help support the show by becoming a member here on YouTube or Patreon, or check out other ways to help at IsaacArthur.net. SFIA's episodes also come out early and ad-free on our streaming service Nebula, like this month's exclusive episode, Caretaker AI and Genus Loci, at go.nebula.tv/IsaacArthur. As always, thanks for watching, and have a great week.